Guys, now we will be discussing the communications in the industrial automation systems. We will discuss the digital inputs, analog input, and analog output. In the digital input signals, we will discuss the single wire connection, two wire connection with line monitoring, digital input with the relay wet contacts, and digital input with the relay dry contacts. Similarly, in digital output, we have two wire connection, digital relay wet contact, dry contact, interfacing with the other control systems and line monitoring. In the analog input signal, we will have single wire connection, two wire connection, three wire connection, and interfacing with the other control systems, and then comes the analog output signal connection. So this is the digital input without relay dry contact. This is the control room side, and this is the field side. This is the PLC card, and this is the instrument, a switch which is either open or closed, and this is the junction box, JB, in between the both devices. So this is the digital input without relay, without using any relay. This is the other digital input without relay, dry input contact with line monitoring. Here we have the line monitoring feature. We can see that two resistances are installed. One is R2, the other one is R1, and R1 is less than R2. We can test the circuit for circuit resistance basically in the open and short conditions. For example, in the open conditions, the R1 and R2 resistances will be in the circuit, and if we short the switch, then only R2 resistance will be in the circuit. So by this, we can easily determine the integrity of the loop. Okay. This is the digital input card with single wire connection. So you can see that the single wire is coming from the control room side, 24 volt DC, the positive side, and it is going to the instrument, and then from the instrument it is returning back to the digital input card, and its common is connected somewhere here. But this is a single wire digital input card. Only one wire is basically running from the control room to the instrument. The other one is with the relay, digital input with relay, wet contact. Please note that we are saying it a wet contact. Wet contact means we are using a power supply in the control room side. Control room side means in the marshalling cabinets or in the system cabinet. Normally this is in the marshalling cabinet. So from marshalling cabinet, it is the wire is, this power supply is getting out and going to JB and instrument, and then it is going back, and a relay is installed in between the digital input card and this power supply. So if the switch is open, then this contact will be open, and if the switch is closed, and the relay will be actuated, and this contact will also can be closed, and the digital input card will sense. So we call it a wet contact, and this is also known as interrogation voltage. This is here the external power supply called as interrogation voltage. The interrogation voltage from the panel can be 24 volt DC, 110 volt DC. So these standards normally followed, mostly 24 volt DC standard is followed. As in my experience, 24 volt DC, I worked on the DCS and PLCs of 24 volt DC system. Now this is the digital input with relay, a dry contact. Dry contact means we don't have a power supply in the control room side. There is power supply, but at the field side. So this will be termed as the dry contact. So this is another configuration for the digital input. So far we are discussing the digital input sides. Okay. Now we come to the Now this is the digital output contact, two wire contact digital output. Here we can see that the digital output, this is JB and this is the instrument. Power goes like this and returns back. So this powers the solenoid, some solenoid or some output device. So this is the digital output without any relay. And this is the digital output with relay. This will be the wet contact. Wet contact means there is supply in the control room side. So here the relay is in between the digital output card and instrument. So we can see that if the digital out is 1, the relay will be rated, and this 24 volt DC will be passed to the instrument. And if the digital output bit and digital output is 0, the supply will not be transferred to the instrument and it will not operate. Okay. Now this comes the digital output with relay, dry contact. Dry contact means there is no power supply in the control room side, but there can be power supply in the field side. And here you can see that this is the digital output pin relay module. Okay. Now this is the digital output with the relay dry contact interface and with the other control systems. Now you can see that this is the main controller and this is the other control system. It can be PLC, DCS, or shutdown switch, emergency shutdown, SPS system. And this is the main controller. Here it is the digital input card. Since we are discussing the digital output, so this is our main control system. From digital output card it goes to the relay, and from this relay it goes to the digital in card of the other control system. So this is digital out and this will be digital in. Okay. Now we come to the analog communication. Here the analog input card with two wire connection. You can see that the two wire analog input card will be two wire connection. Here 4 to 20 milliamps transmitter is installed. This is the most used protocol in the industry, that is 4 to 20 milliamperes. Okay. Now we can see that this is the analog input card with single wire connection. Here we can see that analog input card with a single wire. So single wire 24 volt DC going out and turning to the analog input card. And the current in the loop is 4 to 20 milliamperes. Now this is the digital DCS analog output to PLC analog input. So DCS analog output, other will be PLC analog input. So here we can see that this is active sourcing. This is sourcing because the current is getting out from here. And this is sinking. The current is sinking into the PLC. So it is passive and this is active. Active and passive, it will work. Both active will not work. Similarly, both passive will not work. Here is the PLC is active and DCS is passive. So in that case it will work active and passive. Both active will not work, both passive will not work. And the finally is the analog output with two wire connection. So we can see that here the analog output with the two wire connection. This is the analog output and this is some valve positioner, 4 to 20 milliamp positioner. So to which we are giving the 4 to 20 milliamp. So it will maybe positioner side, or it may be the I2P converter, which is further converting 4 to 20 milliamps to 3 to 15 PSI. So we will discuss the next communication, advanced communication, industrial automation systems in the next lectures. Thank you. We are discussing the advanced communication in industrial automation systems. So now we will discuss 4 to 20 milliampere current loops. We had already discussed this topic in previous course. Here we can see that why we use 4 to 20. So we use the current because the current does not get drops with the distance, as compared to the voltage which gets dropped with the distance. So therefore we use the current 4 to 20 milliampere. Now there are basically 5 components in the 4 to 20 milliampere loops. We can see that one is the sensor, which basically measures the process and converts to the electrical signal. This is the transducer part, electrical transducer. Now the other is the transmitter, which transmits this sensory voltage or current to the 4 to 20 milliampere side. And this is the power source which we require to energize the loop. The fourth one is of course the loop, the communication wires. And the fifth one is the receiver. The receiver at receiving end, we normally have 250 ohm resistance from which we get 4 to 20 milliamps to 1 to 5, which is equal to I of 4. We convert this 4 to 20 into the voltages to the receiver side. So this is how we do the communication in currents, because the current does not get dropped with the distances. So 4 to 20 milliampere current loop is the dominant standard in many industries. It is a simple option, blessed option to connect and configure. It uses less wiring and connections than other signals, greatly reducing initial setup costs. Better for traveling long distances, as current does not degrade over long connections like voltage. It is sensitive to background electrical noise. Since 4 milliampere is equal to 0% output, it is incredibly simple to detect a fault in the system. So this we say this a live 0 instead of 0 milliampere. Because in case if the loop is broken, then we will be getting 0 milliampere, which will show that the loop is broken. That's why we start with the 4 milliampere. So we call it a live 0. Just like in pneumatic systems, we say 3 to 15 PSI. We use get 3 to 15 psi on per scan images. The negative, the disadvantages are current loops can only transmit one particular process signal. Multiple loops must be created in situations when there are numerous process variables that require transmission. Running so much wire could lead to problems with ground loops. Independent loops are not properly isolated. These isolation requirements become exponentially more complicated as the number of loops increase. So this system becomes complicated if there are more than process variables. But this is more of the dominant standard in the industry, and we will be discussing the hard protocol, where we have 4 to 20 milliampere analog communication as well as digital communication embedded on the analog signal. So 4 to 20 milliampere current loop is the prevailing process control signal in many industries. It is an ideal method of transferring process information because current does not change as it travels from transmitter to receiver. It is also much simpler and cost effective. However, voltage drops and number of process variables that need to be monitored can impact its cost and complexity. By knowing these fundamentals, you will be able to make more informed decisions about the process control in your facility, which could affect your bottom line. Now another time, since we are discussing the communication, I am going further in detail. The signals can be transmitted over long distances without being detected by noise. That's why we use the current 4 to 20 milliamps. Now, in the 4 to 20 milliamps, we have 4 wire transmission. In the 4 wire transmission, where we have the 4 conductors, so 2 for the power, to power up the device, and 2 for the communication. Here you can see that there are 4 conductors, 2 for to power up. These are to power up the device, and these 2 are to for the signal conditioning. So this is an expensive system. The other one is the two-wire transmission system. In this transmission system, we have both the power and signal together. So this you can see that the power source, the transmitter side, and this is the receiver side. Only two wires are used, so power and communication signal are combined. So this is the mostly preferred and mostly used method so far. Now this is a simple process control loop diagram. Here we can see that this is the process. It is being sensed by the sensor and it is converted to 4 to 20 milliampere signal and it becomes a process variable signal. This is a feedback loop. This is the PV input and here we have the set point. So SP minus PV generates the manipulated variable and V manipulated variable. It goes to the final control device or actuator and then actuator influences the process which is again sensed by the sensor. So this is how a closed loop control system, industrial control system, automation system works like this. Now here the third one we have, as I already discussed, is the hard communication. Here intelligent or smart transmitter, smart communication, we also say this smart. So there are two types of transmitters in the industry, smart and non-smart. In non-smart we don't have any processor, but in the smart transmission we will be having a processor in the transmitter side, which will be converting analog value to the digital and then going to microprocessor and then from microprocessor digital to analog converter. This analog value will be further transmitted. So this is the smart transmitter. Intelligent or smart transmitters transmit signal or analog signals by the same two cables. A digital signal is superimposed on traditional 4 to 20 milliampere signal. This is the hard communication. Digital signal transmission is faster and more accurate than analog. More information can be transported between the instrument and the control room using the same two cables with a bi-directional digital transmission including configuration and diagnostic information. So in the digital communication we have the flexibility of a greater number of information and parameters can be shared. So in hard we have access to numerous parameters of the transmitter. So that is the beauty of this hard communication. Also, it is a multi-drop communication. We can have multiple devices connected on the same wire. This is also a facility, but normally it's not used. This often makes it possible to remotely diagnose a field device problem, having a costly trip to the field. So instead of going to the field, so this is a transmitter and this is your PLC side. This is the control room and this is the transmitter. Normally, if there is a 1 kilometer distance between these two devices, then what you need to do, you just need to connect a hard communicator here and you can access this. The parameters in the transmitter, you can configure it, you can change its URB and RB upper range value, lower range value, you can change its calibration settings, you can change its 4 to 20 milliampere configuration. So this is a benefit of this hard protocol. Okay. Now this is the diagram. Here we can see that this is 4 to 20 milliampere radiation and superimposed is the 10. One is the, this is the FSK phase shift gain. One is the, you can say 1200 hertz, and 0 is the 2200 hertz. HART protocol provides a uniquely backward compatible solution for a smart instrument communication at both 4 to 20 milliampere analog and digital signals are transmitted simultaneously on the same pin. HART provides many benefits promised by field bus while retaining the compatibility and familiarity of the existing 4 to 20 milliampere systems. So this is then also in that 0.5 milliampere on the upside, positive peak, and 0.5 negative. So this is overall, you can see that the average value is not affecting the 4 to 20 milliampere. So that is the beauty, that the digital signal is not disturbing the analog signal value. The HART protocol enables two-way digital communication with the smart instruments without disturbing the 4 to 20 milliampere analog signal. Both 4 to 20 analog and digital communication can be transmitted simultaneously over the same wire. So this is a diagram. You can see here, this is the transmitter and this is the computer. Here the PLC, maybe the PLC, and this is, there is a distance, this like this is 9800 feet. So here you can connect the HART communicator and then check all the parameter configured this transmitter wireless. I have worked on the 375 model, moreover 471 model. I have worked on both of these. So both 375 and 475 HART communicators are mostly available, mostly used in the modern system here in Pakistan. So now we will further discuss the field bus communication in the next lectures. Thank you. We are now discussing the advanced communication and industrial automation systems. Now we are discussing the field bus communication systems. Field bus is a digital two-way multi-drop communication link among intelligent control devices that can be used instead of 4 to 20 standard. Basically, in 4 to 20 milliampere, we saw that we were using analog to digital and digital to analog control. But in the field bus communication, we don't need this control. So that's the advantage of the field bus communication. Further, it is all still communication, so we will be having greater number of parameters for access and greater number. Moreover, multi-drop communication will also be possible. So multi-drop communication means the digital communication between several field devices such as valves, pressure transducers, and computers, PLCs, RTUs can take place over the same two cables. Multiple drop capacity of a field bus may result in the most immediate cost savings benefit for the system. So you can save a lot of cost of installing separate number of wires for the devices, because only two digital wires can be sufficient for multiple devices in that case, since a single pair of cable is shared across multiple devices. The main advantage of foundation field bus, now there are various types of field bus, and one is the proper bus, other is the foundation field bus. First, we will discuss the foundation field bus. In the foundation field bus, we have the advantage of decision making. The decision making is shared to the field devices. Conventionally, the transmitter sends signal to the control room. From the control room, the signal is sent again back to the actuator. So if the device and the actuator, sensor and transmitter and actuator are together installed in the field, but they will be communicating through control. So that is a long route. In the foundation field bus, we will be having flexibility of decision making towards the field devices. The then transmitter can then send the information to the actuator. So they react according to the sector. So the decision making is transferred to the field site in the foundation field bus. The main advantage of FF foundation field bus is that it allows the relocation of control functions such as PID from the central control to the field bus devices in such a way a cycle can be performed through direct communication between a sensor and a controller. This results in better and more reliable control as well as less complex centralized control system. The current limitation is the communication speed and the limited maximum number of instruments linked to the communication segment. So this is the limitation. So there are two types of foundation field bus and proper bus as I discussed earlier. Firstly, we are discussing the foundation field bus. Now this is the field bus mode that typically the field bus devices today, transmitters, actuators, controllers, indicator devices used in terms of manipulator phases rather than on the set control rooms. The role of PCs and the entire architectures of DCS, digital control systems, and PLCs have also changed.
Honestly, it was an all-digital serial 2-bit application system. There are two types, FF, and now we're discussing the partition. One is the H1 and the other is the HAC. H1 is the communication standard in the devices, the actual present sensors and the ground floor. Whereas the HAC is the standard among the control system in upper level. So H1 31.05 kbps interconnects the field equipment such as sensors and actuators and IOs. HSC high speed internet, 100 Mbps high speed internet provides integration of high speed controllers such as PLCs, H1 subsystems, via linking devices and device servers and workstations. Foundation field bus is the only protocol with the built in capability to distribute the control application across the network. That is the HSC layer, high speed internet, which is connected to many control systems will be connected, and this is the H1 side connected, in which the devices will be connected to this linking, this communication layer. This is H1, this is the HSC. And this is the traditional 420 milliamp, you can see that is separate by 420 milliamp, 1 to 5% is separate by 420 milliamp, it will be much faster than one. And we just have one cable, and this is the multi-drop communication. 1, 2, 3, 4 devices that are connected to this single cable. So this is a lot of cost has been saved, and also the maintenance is also being reduced. We have more diagnostics available, we have more information related faults, and that's very easy to such system. So, foundation field bus in the control system architecture, H1 field bus is used as field electronic transmitters and positioners. HAC high speed internet is used at the high level between linking devices and host workstations. That HAC will not replace H1, but they can complement each other and serve enterprise needs at different levels of the plant hierarchy. So, now you can see that it is HAC. This is already discussed. Also, the PID option in has also been by the control system at the field level. Now this is another good, very good concept clearing slide. Here you can see that in the traditional protocol medium, where we need the digital analog conversion and analog digital convert for the communication between the processor and the computer. But in the field bus, we don't need this. We're just communicating directly. We are saving cost as well as computational time. Now here you can see that this is the field bus most simplified technology. Field bus communication. Field bus has expanded the advantages of distributed control with the following features. It has greatly reduced wiring, it has more scalability, and it has less space. Again, the benefits are multi-vendor interoperability. Multi-vendor means more vendor matching, either EDB, NDB, Siemens, due to an open loop standard, can interconnect CSS PLCs, control can be local. Then that is the PID concept. The new opportunities for advanced control features for manufacturers and users. For example, advanced features such as self-healing capability, fuzzy logic, neural networks. So this is the all advanced control systems we are getting in the future, intelligent controls. The other is the other advantages include the architectural advantages to the field bus lead to stop benefits, which can be placed into three categories: installation benefits, operation benefits, and maintenance benefits. Now, installation benefits include field bus is multi-drop, which reduces the amount of wiring and the cost. Yes, not just of the wire, but also of the terminations and just the drop on this one. Field bus provides standardized access methods to the device parameters of both sensors and elements over the wire, thereby. Now, maintenance benefits, what are the maintenance benefits? Less maintenance because of increased reliability of digital technology. Faster maintenance because digital diagnostics can be specific, leading to faster correction and complete automatic documentation. Okay. Directly tell you what is the fault and where is the fault, so it will save a lot of time as well as production costs. Access to numerous parameters within the smart devices and makes more diagnostics possible. The other is the field bus. Now, in the field, profit bus. The Profibus is the following claims are made for this communication, mostly it is used by the students. It is an open standard that Profibus adheres to the OSI model. We discuss this open system interface OSI model and ensures that devices from a variety of different vendors can communicate together. So, effectively, this is OSI model. We discuss in the videos in detail of this OSI model, computer networks, in detail in the couple of videos. Vendor independent, it is independent of the vendor, it can be used by a vendor of multiple types. Optimized for the implementation area, it is also optimized. Again, its advantage was easy maintenance. The claims are it's easy maintenance. It provides a common solution to all the way from the field to the cell level. It's future oriented. It has the capability for expansion and certification. All products are tested and certified by the test laboratories. Now, this you can see that the Profibus, Profibus PP, and Profibus P. There are two types of Profibus, PP and Profibus P. Profibus DP is basically on the upper side, and Profibus P is basically in the hazardous area side. The communication in the hazardous area and the PA, Profibus process automation. The Profibus DP communication protocol offers high speed communication between systems and centralized devices. It uses cables of the RS-485 standard. We discussed further what is RS-485 modbus communication, RTU, non-TCP, and is mainly 90% of the left slaves on the Profibus networks operate from the Profibus DP. On the other hand, Profibus TA process automation connects field devices and control systems in hazardous areas like those with explosive gas. The Profibus P allows all the field data to travel on the same pair of cables. It also gives the devices new power to reduce the currents that would set off explosions. So, this is using the field devices and especially in the hazardous areas which are classified. Here we use the Profibus P and here we use the Profibus TP at the system level. So, thank you for listening.
Otherwise, now we are discussing advanced communication industrial automation systems. Now, first of all, I will discuss OSI reference model. OSI reference model is a very popular model in communication systems, in computer communication systems. It's a communication network, like here it is shown that to illustrate by analogy, think of all the actions and components necessary to transport items using an automobile. In order to move the furniture from one apartment to a house, for example, you would require the following. For example, if you want to move one stuff from one house to another house, what you will need? You will need an appropriate vehicle, addresses or directions of both locations, a driver's license and knowledge of driving rules, fuel for the vehicle, and knowledge of how to safely stack furniture for the transport, knowledge of how the furniture is to be placed in the house. So you need all this information to shift furniture from one house to the other house. Similarly, in the OSI reference model, we have different layers. So each layer has a function. So for example, by the same token, the task of transporting digital data may be divided into similar categories in order to move and process data from one computer to another computer. This is basically communication, computer communication. One computer is communicating to the other computer. So you will need an appropriate cable connecting the two computers. Yes. Standardized electrical signals to represent bit states, addresses for each computer on the network, algorithms specifying how the computer takes turns talking on the common network, algorithms specifying how to organize packets of data to be sent and received seriously, software to form the data on the transmitting end and interpret the data on the receiving end side. So this all this such information you need for to communicate your message from one computer to another computer. So this is done by the OSI system layer model. So this is the OSI layer model in which we have 7 layers. So layer 1 is the physical layer. This is where the data bits are situated to electrical, optical or other signals. Other physical details such as cable and connector types are also specified here. This is the physical layer. The second layer is the data link layer. This is where the basic data transfer methods and sequences frames are defined within small segments of a network, for example, CSMA or CD token passing on master slave protocols. The third layer is the network layer. This is where the system determines the network-wide addresses, ensuring a means of data to get from one node to another, that is the IP or ERP. Transport layer, therefore, is the transport layer. This is where the complete data transfer is handled, ensuring all the data gets pulled together and error checked before use. Error checking then is performed here. This is TCP and UDP, the reliable and the unreliable data transfer protocols. Layer 5 is where the conversation between the digital devices are opened, closed, and otherwise managed for reliable data. Here the sockets and net BIOS stuff. And the layer 6 is the presentation layer. This is where the data gets converted between different formats, that is ASCII, MPEG, JPG, MP3. And finally, the layer 7. This is where the digital data takes on practical meaning in the context of supplement or overall system function, HTTP, FTP, Telnet, SSH. So this is the OSI layer model, which is basically followed by different vendors of automation systems. Basically, it's a communication model for the computer networks. So this is a separate course of computer networks where we discuss all these things in great detail. But this is not the computer networking course, this is an automation course. And I have to just give you the idea of the things that these things in the automation systems exist. Okay, the first one we will be discussing EIA-TIA-232, that is the RS-232. Protocol. In RS-232 protocol, we have, this is a serial communication protocol in which we have a serial bus. Now please note that this is the mostly used, I have seen this is the mostly used protocol in the industry where we have a laptop, and we, in the new laptops, we are not having any serial ports nowadays. So we have a converter on which we place our laptop, and our, then we have a serial bus. So serial connector. So from serial connector, we connect a cable, DV9 cable, to our PC, to that converter, and the other end is connected to the instrument, and then the communication starts. So RS-232 communication is the mostly used communication in the currently installed instruments in the field. So here you can see that this is the transceiver and single-ended transceiver, and this is also the single-ended transceiver. Here the transmitter is connected to the receiver, and this is transmitter is connected to the receiver, and this is the ground. Now please note that the ground is common for both receiver and transmitter. The ground is common. So ES-232 networks are point-to-point and need to connect only two devices. The signaling is single-ended, also known as unbalanced, which means the respective voltage pulses are referenced to a common ground conductor. These are referenced to a common ground conductor. Both the reference of both the cables is common ground. A single conductor is used to transfer data in each direction. Now this is the connector, DV9 connector 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this is the DV9 connector, which is used for serial communication, and this is the table for pin configuration. And we'll see that some are bold, like receiver, transmitter, and signal ground, because these are essential. These are bold. The other are also maybe required for various applications. Depending upon your application, you can use further features as well. But 1, 2, 3, and 5. 2, 3, and 5 are essential. So, in this protocol, we have a terminal equipment and a communication equipment, data communication equipment, and data terminal equipment. So, DTE and DCE type devices. So, this is DTE type devices, is the terminal device, like a computer. This is the terminal device. And DCE is just like a communication device, which is an interface between two devices. So it is a, you can say this is a data communication device. So DTE and DCE. So in DTE, we have 2 for receiver, 3 number pin for transmitter, and 5 number pin for ground. And in the DCE, we have 2 for the transmitter, 3 for the receiver, and 5 for the ground. So if we want to connect two DTE and DCE devices through RS-232, we will be having this type of connection. 2 will be connected to the 2. This is the receiver will be connected to the transmitter, because if you connect 2 transmitters, you will not be able to have communication. So for communication to occur, you have a transmitter on one side and receiver on the other side. So here you can see that this is the DTE device and DCE devices are communicating through this cable. Receiver is connected to transmitter, and transmitter is connected to the receiver, and this is ground. Now comes the telephone line, which is this is the old communication when we used to have telephone lines for the communication. So, but this gives a better idea for RS-232 communication. Now DCE device, DTE device. Then again we have a DCE device on this end, and this is the data terminal equipment device, and this is the connection. Now it is connected. So this is RS-232 protocol. Connection between two devices. There is also a null modem. Null modem cable. Basically, what is null modem cable here? If we have two DTE devices, then we will be needing two to connect to three, and pin number two here on the right side to connect to three on the left side, because for communication to occur. So, if one desires to connect two DTE devices together using EIA. TIA-232, a special cable called a null modem. Null modem must be used, which swaps the connection between pins 2 and 3 of each device. A null modem connection is necessary for the transmit pin of each DTE device to connect to the receive pin of the other DTE device. The other protocol is in the automation system is RS-422 and RS-485. RS-422 is also less popular. It's popular but less popular. RS-485 is the most popular. Basically, both are serial protocols. Now what's the difference between RS-232 and RS-485? You can see that the differential wires here in the here we have four wires. I did it. The next two network standards are less comprehensive than 232, specifying only the electrical signaling. Okay. To begin with, the electrical signaling used for the both 422 and this is the differential rather than single handed. So here we can see that the communication is differential. This is the receiver, it will be having its common, and transmitter will be having its own common. In the previous view, we saw that in the RS-232, the common, the transmitter and receiver shared a common. Shared single wire for the common, but here they are not sharing. Receiver has its own and transmitter has its own. So further, I will show you what is the advantage of this differential communication. This is the basic advantage we get is the noise reduction. Okay. You can see here that any electrical noise induced along the length of the network cables tend to be fairly equal on all the non-grounded conductors of that cable, but since the receiver's networks respond only to the differential voltages, not the common voltages, induced noise is removed or ignored. You can see this here. For example, this is the transmitting end and this is the receiving end. And here you are transmitting your signal through the cable. Now this is a noise. Here the noise is adding in the system. This is signal plus noise. And this noise will cause the corruption of this transmitted signal, because if there could be one, it can be marked as zero. And if there could be zero with the noise, it can be read as one. So this noise will be affecting your signal on the receiver side in its decoding. So what's the solution? What's the solution is that you use the differential one, like in RS-422 and RS-485. Here you can see that the noise will be affecting both cables. So if the noise is added on the both cables and the output is taken by the difference of the two, then this noise will be cancelled out with this noise. Let's say it's X and it is Y. The output is Z. Z is equal to X minus Y. So noise will be added to X as well as to the Y, and it will be cancelled out. So you see here we get a clean data here. So that is the advantage of differential voltage. The noise is get cancelled. Any noise superimposed on the ungrounded conductors in a differential signaling circuit cancels at the receiver, because the close proximity of these two conductors ensures any induced noise will be the same. Since the receiver responds only to differential voltage between its two inputs, this common mode noise cancels, revealing a clean data signal at the end. So this is the benefit of RS-422 and RS-485. Again, there is a concept to be clear, that the simplex, half duplex and full duplex communication. In the simplex communication, we have one direction of data at a time. And half duplex, we have both directions, but one at a time. Direction of data at a time one, direction of data at a time two. It can communicate on both sides, but at a different times, not together. In the simplex, there was only one direction. In the full duplex side, we have the direction of data all the time. simultaneously it is sending and receiving the data on both sides. Now this is the RS-485 full duplex connections, TB positive, TA negative, RB positive, RA negative, and ground. So ground will be connected here, this is the ground connection, and TB positive will be connected to RB, B positive, and this transmitter needs to be connected to the receiver, and this receiver needs to be connected to the transmitter. Positive side could be connected, should be connected to the positive, negative to the negative. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 4 5s in this. This is 485 full duplex connection. Okay, and this is also a very popular 2-by-multi-point connection, but this is a half duplex connection. You can see here popular connection scheme for TA-485 half duplex operation. So here you can see that DB positive, and this is just like a multi-drop. Multi-point or multi-drop communication. So this is also another type of communication, RS-485 half duplex. Now this is another note, please. This communication network here, we have the two devices, digital network devices, on the extreme sides, one on this end and the other on this end. And this is the end of line resistor. This is known as end of line resistor, EOL. So here we on the left side, and on the right side we have this. And this is the our trunk cable. We call it a trunk cable, and these are the branches. You say it's stub or spur. These are basically the branch devices. 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 branch devices are connected in parallel on this trunk cable, and these are 2 terminating devices on the left and the right side. So this is also a communication network. We will see in the coming lectures that how in the practical industrial automation systems we have such communication networks. But now I am just discussing the brief basics so that you have an idea of these things. Now the other communication protocol is the Ethernet networks. Ethernet protocol is the most very popular. In fact, you can say the most popular, very popular in the industrial networks, because it has it is CSMA. This we will discussing further. This means its carrier sends multiple access with collision detection. The collisions are do not occur in the Ethernet. So it was developed in 1973, and it is being widely used in the automation system. The CSMA/CD method of bus arbitration works by giving each Ethernet device the ability to sense an idle channel, as well as sense if it happens to collide with another transmitting device. It's just like our communication in the class, that if someone is going to say, and if the collision happens, the two transmitters start sending the data, then both will stop, and there will be delay between the two devices. So when one device completes the channel becomes empty, and then all the devices sense the channel. If the channel becomes empty, then the transmitter starts transmitting device, and if there occurs a collision between the two transmitting devices, then there occurs a delay. So this is a full protocol again, and this is the topic of computer networks. It's a full course in which we discuss in detail the working of Ethernet networks and all such stuff. But in the industrial automation, in this course, I'm discussing briefly about the basics. So this is the commonly used cable. In RJ45 connector, you have also used in your hostels as well. Along with the hubs came from the Ethernet cable and connector, unshielded twisted pair. This is the unshielded twisted pair. Mostly we use the sheeted twisted pair STP cables, and there is a shield to remove the noise effect of noise on the cable, and then twisted pairs. The pairs are twisted. So this is a pin number 1, 2, 3, 4. So basically there are two types of RJ45 connections: straight connection and cross connection. So here we can send them white, green, white, orange, then blue, orange, white, then white, brown, and brown, white. And the two types of connections are PC, straight connection, and cross connection. This is important for the automation point of view, that sometimes we are connecting a cable, the devices are not communicating, because of the cable has not been cable is not proper. The connectors, RJ45 connectors, are not proper. So there are two types of connectors: straight connector and cross. In straight connector is when we have PC and hub. It's just like DTE and DCE devices, as I previously discussed in the RS-232. Here, if the device is between PC to PC, then we need a crossover. Okay. Here you can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And this is the color code of the straight through connections, and this is the color code of the crossover connections. We need to cross. For the crossover connection, you need to connect this wire to 6 number and 6 number wire to 2 number. So this is the difference. Here again 3 number will be connected to 1 number like this in the crossover. So this is the difference between straight through and crossover connector. If the devices are similar, like PC, two PCs are similar devices, so if you are communicating these, you need a crossover cable. And if the devices are different, like a PC and a hub, you need use straight connections there. Now IP address, again IP address IP address we discussed in industrial process control. Again in Ethernet we basically communicate with this address. This address is basically 250.0.0.0.0. basically 8 1 1 1 1 byte. We see this again further. Here we can see that if two computers are going to connect, then we need to have we basically in internet protocol we have a network ID and a host ID. So the network ID should be the same for both devices to conduct, and host ID can be different. Here you can see that this is IPv4. Basically two types of IP addresses we have, IPv4 and IPv6. In the IPv4 we see that we have 32 bits here, 8 bits here, 172, and then 8 bits, and 8 bits. So this whole combination is your IP address. So you need to know this IP address. Further in computer communications, you need to know the subnet mask, you need to know the DNS server. We will be discussing this in briefly further. So this is the IPv4 address, internet protocol address, and these are the classifications: class A, class B, class C, class D, and class D. So in the class A we have first byte for the network ID and byte 2, 3, and 4 for the host IDs. In the class B we have 2 bytes for the network ID and then for the host ID 2 bytes, and in the class C we have 3 bytes for the network ID and 1 byte for the host ID, and then we get the class B multicast address and then class E that is reserved. So this is the classifications of IP addresses. Now if you want to connect your computer to router, so there is a protocol which is DHCP protocol. We will further discuss in coming videos here. There is dynamic host router porting router protocol communication. Here we can see that if you connect it with the router, this computer, then it will automatically assign it the settings like this. If we have a router here, this is the WAN. We'll discuss this further, WAN, MAN, next in the coming lecture videos. So this is 212.445.19.17 router, and this is the LAN IP 192.168.1. this is the local area network. So its IP address is .1. So if it wants to assign this computer an IP address, it will assign .2. It may assign it .2. So addresses, it has various addresses. It has 2 to 254, so it can assign that PC any address from 2 to 254. So it has subnet mask 255.255.255 and 190. We have discussed all these things in the previous course in the industrial process control. That's why I'm not going in very details in this, but I'm just getting you reviewed or recalled from that course. Here you can see that the IP address 192.168.1.2. This is the IP address being assigned by DHCP protocol to this computer, and this is subnet mask and default gateway and DNS. So this is all this thing is automatically done by this DHCP. So when a computer connects a network, it will try to ask for an IP address. This is done by sending out a DHCP request when it asks if there are any available DHCP servers or the network. If any DHCP server responds, then the computer will use DHCP to ask for an IP address and all other necessary information it needs from the DHCP server. So when your router sees the DHCP request, it will handle out an available IP address from its pool of free IP address together with the other details that the computer needs. So in the above example, the router DHCP server has a pool of IPs available starting from 2 to 254. The router will hand out the first available IP from that pool and will mark the address of a least so that it does not hand out the same IP to any other client. Now the other version is IPv6. Here, because of the greater number of devices which are getting connected to the IP, the addresses have been increased to IPv6. Here we have the two bytes extra with the conventional 4 byte system, 32 bit system. So for what will be the advantage, which would be the greater number of expansion. And expansion basically its purpose is for the expansion of the existing network. Okay, the next is the DNS, the domain name server. Domain name server, the domain name server is basically the name for the IP addresses we use. For example, www.google.com, this is the DNS, domain name server name for the IP address, this 75.125.53.104. Okay, special computers connected to the internet called the domain name servers, and the domain name resolvers use the address resolution protocol ARP to convert your target website name to its actual IP address so that a connection may be made when that computer ends. So in the web browser you type the google.com, but what an ARP uses, it converts that google.com into its address. So that's the meaning of that's the meaning of this interesting ARP and DNS systems. Okay. Now, other finally is the Modbus communication in the industry, which I gave the idea earlier that RS-232 and RS-485 basically. The Modbus, we have the RS-485 network, we also call it. Now, there are two types of Modbuses, Modbus RTU and Modbus TCP/IP. Modbus TCP/IP uses the transmission control protocol or internet protocol of the computer networks, and Modbus RTU uses the serial communication connectors on the both sides. So the Modbus standard does not specify any details of physical networking and thus may be developed on any number of physical, such as 232, 485 or the NAT TCP/IP. Like I said earlier, that it can be implemented, it is implemented in the industry two ways, TCP/IP or RTU. RTU is the serial protocol. TCP/IP using the Ethernet. So Modbus, especially when implemented over simple serial RS-232 port, was rather primitive protocol. Okay, we discuss it. This is the table of the Modbus. This is the table, and there are ports on the Modbus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 15, and 16. So these are the ports. We are not going to that much in detail, but these if sometimes we need these tables for if the communication is not working, we see that what is the fault, and we need to consult this table in the industry field. But again, it is quite design level approach. Our CLO for this course is not on that level, therefore I'm just giving you the idea. Now here you can see that this is the actual practical system. Communication. Here you can see that there is a PLC of Schneider and there is a computer which are connected to this wire, and this is the Modbus network. Again, please note that Modbus is a master-slave communication in which there will be one master and there can be multiple slaves. So this is a slave and this is a slave. Master will initiate the communication and slave will respond. Slave cannot initiate the communication. So please note that. Okay. So this is a network, a Modbus network in the industry, PLC network. And this is another network in which we have the PLC here. It is the Modbus TCP master. Now this is the Modbus TCP protocol here. Since it is TCP, it will be having the IP address 192.168.10.31. So this is the network ID. Network ID is 192.168.10, and this is the host ID. Similarly, on the slave side, this is the slave, and its IP address can be 192.168.10.5. Now both are communicating to the Ethernet switch. So this is also a communication network, industrial automation. Okay, this is another industrial automation network. Here we have the Modbus TCP/IP fast Ethernet on the upper layer, and then PLCs which are connecting, and this is the network. And then here we have the Modbus RS-485 RTU Modbus. Here we have connecting the devices on the door side. This is Modbus RTU, and this is the fast Ethernet on which the enterprise level computers are connected. And this is the Modbus fast TCP/IP. This is Modbus RTU-485. As I explained earlier, that there are two types of Modbus devices: Modbus communication, TCP/IP, and RTU, Modbus RTU. So we will discuss further our communication and advanced automation system in the next video. Thank you for listening. Now we'll be discussing the computer networking concepts. Please note that we need to understand the computer network concepts, because PLCs are basically computers which are designed for the harsh environments. So we need to understand the computer networking. Again, there is a separate course of computer networking. For further details, more in depth, you may go through that course. But for the time being here, we need to have basic concepts. So in basic networking concepts, we will be discussing introduction, protocols, layers, and network, internet further. Okay. Now, a network can be defined as a group of computers and other devices connected in some way so as to be able to exchange the data. Each of the devices on the network can be thought as a node. Each node has a unique address. So on the network, every device can be termed as a node, and it will have a unique address, an IP address. Addresses are numeric quantities that are easy for the computers to work with, but not for the humans to remember. For example, 204.160.241.98. We discussed this IPv4 earlier. Some networks also provide names that humans can more easily remember than number, like Java. So this is the DNS activity basically. So here you can see that. And here this is an this is a network here address. Addresses are assigned to each device, and this is NIC. NIC is basically network interface card. So addressing internet address, it consists of four quite separated by periods 136.102.233.49. R byte, this is the network ID, and H byte is the host ID. So R.H, it is in the form of R.H. Inter NIC register organization in charge of the allocation of the address regions corresponding to the networks. Criteria considered geographic area, organization, department, or host. We will discuss further. The DNS is the domain name system. Mnemonic textual addresses are provided to facilitate the manipulation of internet addresses. DNS servers are responsible for translating mnemonic textual internet addresses into hard numeric internet addresses. So DNS will be converting the names into the IP addresses. Ports. An IP address identifies a host machine on the internet. An IP port will identify specific application running on an internet host machine. A port is identified by number, the port number. So there will be the port numbers on your network, on your devices. The port numbers is not functionally limited in construct to serial communication, where only four ports are allowed. So there are some ports which are dedicated, for example, HTTP port, 80 port, FTP, we have 20 and 21 port. Buffer ports. So these are communication ports through which the communication takes place. Data transmission. In the modern networks, data transferred using packet switching. Messages are broken into units called the packets. So you might have studied this in communication course also. It is again detailed, discussed in detail in computer networking course. We are just having an idea here. Messages are broken into all the packets and sent from one computer to another. At the destination, data are extracted from one or more packets and used to reconstruct the original message. Each packet has a maximum size and consists of a header and a data. So there will be a header and a data. Header will be the address, like source address, destination address, to from which it is coming and to where it go, it has to go, and the data in which there is actual data. And also sometimes a check, redundancy check, that to check the whether any bit in the data has corrupted or not. The header contains the address of the source and destination of computer, sequencing information necessary to reassemble the message. Happy. So this you can see, this is the header and this is the header. So this is a packet, communication packet. Now, in the types of networks, there are various kinds of networks. We will discuss further in detail, but here we see that WAN, WAN, wide area network, and local area networks. So wide area network, it basically covers cities or metropolitans. It covers cities, countries, and continents based on packet switching technology. Examples of WAN technology are asynchronous transformer, ATM, and integrated services digital network, ISP. And the other thing is LAN is limited as compared to WAN. It covers the building or the set of closely related, for example, a hospital building or a campus building. Examples of LAN technology like Ethernet protocol, token net protocol, fiber distributed data interconnect, and KDI protocol. Ethernet LANs based on the bus topology. We will discuss the topologies further in next slides. Bus topology in broadcast communication, token ring LANs based on the token ring topology, and FTTI LANs use the fiber optics optical fibers and improved token ring mechanism based on the two rings for many opposite directions. Basically, the main purpose is to avoid collisions and safe and reliable data communication. So this is the, you can say that this is the shared bus, this is the bus communication, this is the bus communication, this is the token ring one, and this is the FDTI plan using the fiber optics cable. This is the FDTI, a dual, this is single ring and this is dual plan. So there are three types of plans, normally we have Ethernet plan, token ring plan, FDTI. Now in the industrial automation systems, we will be having PLCs for these computers. So we will be discussing the next week lectures that how this computer networking applies in the industrial automation system. Basically all things are like this, but the computers will be replaced with the PLCs. In network topology diagram, this is very important. We need to have a network topology diagram in the DCS system. We generally have this, and we ask to whether that give us the topology diagram, how the things are connected together. So the specification of network topology diagram requires the duration of the characteristics and it can underline the network, geographical locations of different components or subnets involved in the network, description of the LAN topology, description of the WAN topology, description of the network connectors such as routes, routers, bridges, repeaters and gateways. Protocols. It defines, protocol basically a rule, communication rule. It defines the rules that govern the communications between two computers connected to the network. Roles: addressing and routing of the messages, error detection, recovery, sequence and flow controls. A protocol specification consists of the syntax, which defines the kinds and formats of the messages exchanged, and the semantic, which specifies the action taken by each entity when specific events occur. So this is syntax and semantic, very specialized terms in computer networking. Another very good course is the CCNA. You can do this on your own if you want, have an interest in the computer networks. Again, you just have to have an idea for being a good automation engineer. You need to have an idea of these networks. HTTP protocol for communication between web browsers and servers. So what is the computer network? But computer network is a group of two or more interconnected computer systems. You can establish a network connection using either cable or wireless medium. So what are the advantages? It helps you to connect multiple computers together to send and receive information when accessing the network. It helps to share printers, scanners, emails, helps you to share information. Electronic communication is more efficient and less expensive than without the network. So this is a computer network. Here we can see that there is a firewall between internet and this local network, printer, PC, laptop, tablet, PC, mobile, laptop. Switches. Switches work as controller which connects. Switch is just like a switch connect for connecting the items to the network, which connects computer, printers and other hardware devices to a network in a campus or building. It allows devices on your network to communicate with each other as well as with other networks. It helps you to share resources and reduce costing of any organization. Routers. Routers help you to connect with multiple networks. It enables you, if you have multiple networks, you can connect these two routers. It enables you to share a single internet connection with multiple devices and saves money. This networking component acts as a dispatcher, which allows the networks that data send across the network. It automatically selects the best route for data to travel and send it out. So now, in the computer networking course, we study these routers working in great detail, and we study these protocols in which this selects the data on which it automatically selects the best group for data. This is a protocol to discuss this in great, but no need here. Servers are computers that hold shared programs, files and network operating systems. Servers allow access to network resources to all the users of the network. Clients are the computer devices which access and uses the network as well as share network resources. They are the users of the network. They can send and receive. So this is the client-server communication. Client requests the service and server provide the data or information to the client. Transmission media. The transmission media is a carrier used to interconnect computers in the network, such as coaxial cable, twisted pair cable, optical fiber film cable. This is the transmission media. Access points. Access points allow devices to connect to the wireless network without cables. A wireless network allows you to bring new devices and provide selectable supporting to the mobile users. Shared data. Here data are data which is shared with clients, such as data files, print access programs, and a network interface card. Network interface card sends, receives, and controls data flow between computer and the network, and that becomes the local operating system. There is a network operating system and local operating system. The local operating system, which helps the personal computers to access print files, print to local prints, and use one or more CD drives to operate on the computer. Network operating system. The network operating system is a program which runs on the computers and servers. It allows the computers to communicate via the network. Protocol. A protocol is a set of defined rules that allows two entities to communicate across the network. Some standard protocols used for the purpose of IP, TCP, UDP, FTP. Hub. Hub is a device that splits network connection into multiple computers. It acts as a distribution center, so whenever a computer requests any information from a computer or from the network, it sends the request to a hub through the cable. The hub will receive the request and transmit to the entire network. Okay. The LAN cable is the Ethernet cable used for connecting a device. So these are all the components of the computer. OSI, already I discussed, Open System Integration, is the Open System Integration, the reference model which allows you to specify standards for the communication. Basically, it's a seven layer model. We discussed that first one was the physical and seventh one was the application layer. So you need to remember these things. Below given are some unique network identifiers, host name. Every device of the network is associated with a unique device which is called the host name. IP address, DNS server, MAC address. Now this is new one. MAC address, media access control address. This is basically the address of the physical address of the hardware, NIC, your NIC card. It is known as physical address. It's a unique identifier of each host and is associated with the NIC network interface card. General length of the MAC address is 12-digit, 6 bytes, 48 bits. Port. Port is a logical channel which allows the network users to send or receive data to an application. Every host can have multiple applications running. Each of these applications are identified using the port. We have already discussed the ports previously, dedicated subports. And then comes the network components R and RARP. This is for the DNS type of servers to convert the IP address into the names. ARP stands for Address Resolution Protocol, which helps network users to convert the IP addresses into the corresponding physical addresses. And RARP is the Reverse Address Resolution Protocol. It gives an IP address of the device with given physical address in. Uses on the this is the reverse, basically ARP and reverse. The ARP, we have the which helps convert the IP address to its corresponding physical. It converts the IP address to the physical, and the RARP will convert the physical to the IP address. It uses off computer networks. It helps you to share the resources such as printers. Again, I must state that we are studying just to have an idea of industrial automation system networks. That the PLC is also just like a computer. So for this we have to have an idea of the computer networks. It helps you to share the resources such as printers, allow you to share expensive software and database among network participants, provides fast and effective communication, helps you to exchange data and information via the network. Now disadvantages: investment for the hardware and software can be costly. You don't take proper security precautions like file encryption, firewalls, then your data will be at risk. So that is cyber security, that is very important aspect of computer network. Some components of the network design may not last for many years and can become unless or malfunction and need to be replaced. So it will be required maintenance. It requires time for constant administration. There must be an administrator here for the computer, but for the PLC network we don't need any. It only gets corrected when there is fault by the automation engineer. Frequent server failure and issues of regular cable faults. So summary, computer network is a group of two or more interconnected computer system. Computer network helps you to connect with multiple computers, switches work as controllers, routers help you to connect to multiple networks, servers are computers that hold shared programs, clients are computer devices which access and uses the network, hub is a device that splits the network connection into multiple computers. So access points allow the devices to connect to the wireless network without cables. So when we have the access points in wireless networks, network interface card sends, receives, and controls data. So this is the NIC. Okay, a protocol is a set of defined rules which allow two entities to communicate across the network. Host, IP address, DNS server, and host are important unique identifiers. ARP, Address Resolution Protocol, and ARIA, Reverse Address Resolution Protocol, gives an IP address of the device to the given physical address. Okay, computer network helps to share expensive software and data with multiple. But the biggest drawback of installing computer network is that its initial investment for the hardware and software can be costly. Further, some definitions. Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol. Now the name came, DHCP. It assigns IP addresses to client devices such as desktop computers, laptops, and phones when they are plugged into the internet or connected to the wireless network. So it works on the automatic way. Ethernet, a type of network protocol, it defines the types of cables and connections that are used by computers, which is used most often. Ethernet cabling is CAT 5, category 5 or 6. We call it CAT 5 cable. CAT 5 cable, CAT 6 cable, and up to CAT 7 cable are possible. Hub, a networking device that repeats the traffic it receives to all connected devices, switch, router, and firewall. So these are the some components of the computer network. Now, hopefully, you understand all these names and you know these things. So when we will be discussing automation systems in the next lecture, hopefully you will be familiar with these terms. So for the next networking, little bit more concepts are remaining, so we will discuss in the next video. So thank you for listening, guys. We are discussing communication in advanced industrial automation systems. So we are discussing computer networking. A computer network is defined as the interconnection of two or more computers. It is done to enable the computers to communicate and share available resources. Application, it's sharing of resources such as printers, sharing of expensive softwares and database, communication from one computer to another computer, exchange of data and information among users via network, sharing of information over geographically wide areas. That is to share area from one country to another country, for example. Okay. Networking. Computer networks have opened up an entire frontier in the world of computing called the client-server model. So this is the mostly used model, client-server. Client gives a request to the server and server provides according to its request. Advantages of computer networks is increased speed, reduced cost, improved security, centralized software management systems, electronic mail like email, and flexible access. It also has some disadvantages, which are high cost of installation. It requires time for administration. Usually there are separate IT resident engineers who need these to maintain the system properly. Also, if the server fails, the whole system can collapse. Further, cable faults. These are the faults which are normally occur and give troubles. So these are the disadvantages of computer networks. Classification of area by their geography. Now this is a very famous model, that network, which is a pan, land, van, man, and can. We will discuss one by one. Pan, personal area network. A personal area network is a computer network organized around an individual person. It generally consists of a mobile computer, cell phone, or personal digital assistant. PAN enables the communication among these devices. It can also be used for communication among personal devices themselves for connecting to a digital level network and internet. The PANs can be constructed using wireless or cables. So the first one is the personal area network for one computer. Like you can see that this is the one computer and it is connected to various devices. So this will be a personal area network for one person. Local area network. LAN. Local area network, which is designed to operate over a small physical area such as an office, factory, or a group of buildings, like a hostel network, that would be a LAN, local area network. LANs are easy to design and troubleshoot. Exchange of information and sharing of resources becomes easy because of LAN. In LAN, all machines are connected to a single cable. Different types of topology such as star, tree, bus, ring can be used. We'll discuss this further. So this is a local area network example. It can be a hostel network, a building network. The third one is wide area network, WAN. When network spans over a larger distance or when the computers to be connected to each other are at widely separated locations, a local area network cannot be used. A wide area network is installed. The communication between different users of WAN is established using leased telephone calls, satellite links, and similar channels. It is cheaper and more efficient to use the phone network for the link. So this is the WAN. If, for example, if you are trying to connect two cities, then you can say WAN. Two cities or two geographical areas, different areas, then it will be WAN. Wide area network. So most WAN networks are used to transfer large blocks of data between its users. So here you can see LAN, various buildings or various areas, geographical areas. Then you have a total network of various LANs, that is a WAN, wide area network. Then the metropolitan area network, which is in between the LAN and WAN technology, that covers the entire city. It uses similar technology as LAN. It can be a single network such as cable TV network, major of connecting a number of LANs and a large number of networks so that resources can be shared, LAN or LANs as well, device to device. So this is the metropolitan area network. You can say within a city, for example, Faisalabad city, Lahore city, so that will be a metropolitan area network, city area network. So this is the metropolitan area network, LAN, and it's just like a WAN. You can say it's in between the LAN and WAN. Okay. Campus area network, CAN. The campus area network is made up of an interconnection of LAN with limited geographical areas. Now please note that some authors say the main things are PAN, LAN and WAN, and the others are drawn from these things like MAN, and this is CAN, campus area network. The campus area network is made up of an interconnection of LAN with limited geographical area. Network equipment such as switches, routers and transmission media, that is optical fiber, are almost entirely owned by the campus owner. So this is a campus area network, that is you can also say this is a campus university campus area. You can say that this is a CAN network, campus area network. So distinguish between LAN, WAN and MAN, as I discussed earlier. The ownership LAN in its private, WAN it's public or private, MAN it's public or private. In geographical area covered, LAN is small, WAN is very large, MAN is moderate, in between LAN and WAN. Design and maintenance, easy, not easy, and for the MAN it's also not easy, it's difficult. WAN and MAN are difficult to design and maintain. LAN is some easy because of localness, a limited area. Communication medium is coaxial cable in LAN, PSTN or satellite links. PSTN is a telephonic line. PSTN standard, its abbreviation is not defined, but it's telephonic links. MAN is coaxial cables, PSTN optical fiber cables and wireless. Bandwidth low, WAN high, and MAN is moderate. Similarly, data rate speeds, LAN has high speed because of the low area to be covered, it's the closeness in the devices. WAN has some low, MAN is moderate, in between LAN and WAN. So okay, now we will be discussing the topologies. Network topologies are very important, especially when you go to the industry, when you are working on the DCS or a SCADA system. You ask the vendor to provide them the topology. What is the topology of the control system? The physical topology of a network refers to the configuration of cables, computers and other peripherals. So there are three types of topologies: bus topology, ring topology and star topology. In bus topology, I will briefly discuss the details here and then I will go through the slides. In bus topology, we have a bus type structure like this. Now if the fault occurs here or the cable is broken, then these two will be disconnected and communication will be halted. In the ring topology, we have the flexibility. All items are connected in ring. For example, if the fault occurs here, then that computer can communicate to this through this route. So we have multiple routes, two routes we have available. On the other way around, if the communication is not possible through direct, it can be through the other way around. The other thing is the star topology. In the star topology, we have the star like network, like all are connected to this common point, focal point. But if there is a problem in star topology, if a fault occurs in the focal point or center, then the whole network will get disturbed. So this is the problem with the star topology. So here we then we use redundancy. That point is made redundant, can be made redundant to increase the reliability of start topology. Okay. In bus topology, all computers and devices are connected to a central cable. Generally, a LAN-like structure is like this in the campus. It consists of a main runoff cable with a terminator edge at each end. That is cable only category 5, 6 or 7, CAT 5 or CAT 6, cable we discussed earlier, Ethernet cable. Popular on the LANs because they are inexpensive and easy to install. So this is popular strategy, bus topology. So this is the example of bus topology. Okay. The other is ring topology. In the ring, all are connected in ring. It cable forms closed loop, closed ring or loop with all computers and devices arranged along the ring. It's just like a interconnected system in the power system. For example, in the bus system, we have a radial bus and then we have a ring main system where we have a loop of the or mesh of the buses and various sources are connected at various points. Okay. The cables form the closed loop or link with all computers and devices arranged along the ring. Its data travels from device to device around the entire ring in one direction. Primarily is used for LANs but also is used in WANs, wide area networks. Okay. I was also studying that in smart grids there is also HAN with H, that is a home area network. That was basically the charging of the smart house with the plug-in electric vehicle. So that is also, that will also be come in the textbooks in the coming days. Okay. Ring topology. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is the ring topology. We can see that all items are connected in ring. We also discussed earlier that there is also a dual ring system where we have the dual ring, that is the FDDI system. Okay. Now comes the okay, start. All devices connected to a central device called a hub. So this is the hub. This is the connector of all devices. But if the fault arises in hub, what will you do? So that is the problem of start topology. All data transfer from one computer to another passes through the hub. So this hub is normally the start point. You can see this. This is the start topology. So this is the third topology. First one is the bus topology, then is the ring topology, and finally is the start topology. And another is the mesh topology, which is a mesh system. Various, it is a mixture of all above. In the mesh topology, each computer are connected with each other by separate cable, create point-to-point connection to every device on the network. If one cable fails, data always have alternative path to get to its destination. So you have multiple paths. On a large scale, you can connect multiple LANs using mesh topology with leased line. This topology generally used in the military area. So we can communicate to this through various ways. So here this item is connected to other items through various ways. There are various links for the connection. So this forms a mesh structure. So this is all about the various circuit topologies of computer networks. These are the basic topologies. Advanced topologies are also possible, but for the course, in this course we will be discussing only this. So thank you for your listening.
Yes. Now we are discussing advanced communication industrial automation systems. Now we will be discussing the field bus devices in detail. Foundation field bus is a standard for digital instrumentation, enabling field instruments to not only communicate with each other digitally but also to execute all continuous control algorithms such as PID, tissue control, cascade control, feed forward control, traditionally implemented in dedicated control devices. In essence, foundation field bus extends the general concept of a distributed control system DCS all the way to the field devices. Now please understand this, as I already discussed earlier in the class, the purpose of foundation field bus is to give the control decisions to the field side. In the traditional system, we will discuss this in detail as well here. What is done in the traditional signal, we have a transmitter that gives the PV value and a control system that is installed in the control room side, and then again an actuator which is again on the field side. Now what happens, The transmitter is 1 kilometer away from the control. Now it gives signal to the control room. It travels to 1 kilometer to control room, and then again the controller decides something, and then it sends the signal to the actuator, which is again installed near the transmitter, which is again 1 kilometer control room from control room. Now the 2 kilometer distance has been traveled for transmitter to valve communication. Now this can be made easy that if we give this decision making power, the PID controller, towards the field side, then the transmitter at the field side sends the signal to the actuator and then decides what should be done according to the set point. So this is the basic foundation idea behind the foundation field bus instruments. For brevity, foundation field bus will be abbreviated as FF2 of the rest of this chapter. One of the selling points of the FF is the decreased installation time, which makes this a more attractive technology for brand new installations than for retrofit projects. So with this, it's decreased installation time. It is just a single wire instead of multiple wires for transmitters and actuators. We have just a single wire. And again, since it is a digital communication, we will not be needing any analog to digital and digital to analog converters. Okay. Now this is the traditional setup. Here you can see that this is the traditional DCS system where we have the transmitter, separate wire for the transmitter, 4 to 20 mA signal that goes to the controller, and then the signal travels back to the actuator again 4 to 20 mA. So that is the conventional system. All automatic control decisions are made here. This is the control system, this is the control room side, and this is the control network on which the various stations are connected, maybe the Ethernet connection. This is the conventional one. So nowadays this 4 to 20 has been replaced with the heart. In the heart we have the option of digital as well. We have a greater number of parameters for diagnostics also available. So this is the modern system. I have worked on the Foxboro system, IA series, intelligent series, version 4.0. Now on this system, again, this type of system was there, and this instead of 4 to 20, we had the hard protocol. Okay, information is communicated in analog from between the DCS controllers and the field instruments. If they equipped with the proper types of IO cards, then DCS may even communicate digitally with some of the field instruments using hard protocols. This allows remote configuration and diagnostic testing of field instruments from the power system. We can connect the hard communicator at the control room side instead of going to the transmitter on the field side, or from anywhere around the cable when using a handheld hard communicator. Now please see this. This is an advanced one with the Profibus. I already taught you in the previous lectures that there are two types of Profibus: Profibus DP and Profibus PA. Profibus DP is on the high side network, on the high speed network, and Profibus PA is on the lower side, the actuator side, factory side. It's on the factory side. So it is even a factory floor side, you can say. It is even possible to build a control system around the DCS using all digital field instruments using a protocol such as Profibus PA. That is for the area instrumentation to exchange the process variable and manipulated variable and MA signals to and from the DCS controllers at a digital speed for exceeding that of the heart. So the speed will be greater, further the diagnostics and the parameters will be greater here. And the digital communication. Each field bus cable is a multi-drop digital network. Multi-drop network, I already discussed this previously in detail in class. On one single wire, we drop multiple instruments, permitting the multiple field buses per cable and consequently reducing the total cable length and connecting count. Coupling devices may be used in lieu of the terminal blocks to conveniently connect multiple instruments together for common networks leading to DCS. Coupling devices. Now here you can see that this is the foundation field bus network. We already discussed earlier that for the foundation field bus we have two types of networks. That is the HSC network, high speed Ethernet, and the other is the H1 network, that is on the equipment part like sensors and actuators. Low speed 31.2 kbps. A foundation field bus goes one step further by allowing all control algorithms to be executed within the field instruments rather than relying on the DCS controllers to make automatic control decisions. So you can see that this is the high speed Ethernet network and this is the H1 network. Okay, and this is the coupling device. Please note that this is the coupling device for coupling various devices. It's just like a hub. Now, TCS with the analog I/O partner, you can see that this is the conventional system in which we have the 4 to 20 milliamp pair signal. We have the analog input card and analog output cards, and this is the PID control. This is the conventional TCS system. Analog output VFD is also analog output 4 to 20 milliamp to vary the speed from 0 to 1500 RPM or whatever RPM is the of the motor. Okay. Each functional block has nothing to do. The conversion of 4 to 20 milliamp signals from the transmitter into a scale digital number values, TCS take as analog input function blocks. So these are the AI blocks. Each function block is nothing more than a segment of programming code including the TCS microprocessor what to do with the signals. Now, with the foundation field bus, we will be replacing the separate wires. Here you can see that separate wire for transmitter, separate wire for this transmitter. Again, for if we are going to install this in the field, there will be a lot of cost. There will be a lot of cost for this cable installation, its commissioning, its laying in labor cost. Many cables here you can see that. But in the digital, you have just only single cables. One cable is going up like this, and one cable, one. So now it is common the profit bus PA here. The field instruments are entirely digital communicating with each other via the digital signals over a network cable to the DCS. This means none of the cables handle analog signals anymore, necessitating the A to D and A to D. Again, A to D and A to A conversions will not take place in the profit bus network. It also means that we may do away with the old analog I/O cards in the DCS stack, replacing them with a single network. AI rack, EO rack, analog output, all are replaced just with this simple card in which the PID controllers are implemented. Analog digital signal conversion and scaling operation, however, can within the field instruments themselves. Such is the nature of digital networks that multiple instruments may share the same communication cable to the DCS, with each instrument taking turns communicating in that. One cable will be shared among the all others. This is known as multi-drop communication. Okay, if you say only one cable foundation cables and then single cable, single cable, single, that will be, this is a coupling device, please note, these are the separate cables here, but one cable can be shared among these. These are sharing this thing. So this you can say a single load. This is a single load here. So this is the foundation field bus device. Here you can see that the difference is here is that the PID function has been given to the field devices. Here the PID function was in the controller, even in the PA network, buffer bus automation. But in the foundation field bus, you can see that the PID function has been given to the field bus. Like PID is here in the transmitter side, and here in the control valve actuator side, and this is also the actuator side. So this is the basic difference for the foundation field bus communication. With each revolutionary step in system design, the trend has been to push the control algorithms further into the field away from the central control node, further into the field away from the central control system. Foundation field bus is the ultimate realization in this trend, where the field instrument themselves can do all necessary control functions. Initial configuration and maintenance tools for the FM instruments provide operators with an interface along indication and adjustment of control parameters, record long-term historical data on the process being controlled. In fact, given the right foundation field bus system design, the TCS could even be disconnected from the FF network. Yes, you can disconnect the TCS. If you disconnect this, why? These things will continue to work because the PID function is here. You have the AI for this AO. So even if it is disconnected, it will continue to work. That is the beauty of this system. In fact, given the right FF system design, the DCS could even be disconnected from the FF network, and the FF instruments would continue to control the process as they did before. Foundation field bus merely gives one the ability to do all control tasks in the field instead of, that's why it's known as field bus, foundation field bus instead of centralized computer. When the FF standard was being designed, the two different networks were planned, a low speed network for the connection of field instruments to each other, that is the H1 segments, and the high speed network HSE, which is the backbone for conveying the large amount of process data over long distances. Low speed field network is designated as H1, while the high speed plant network was defined H2 or HSE. Ethernet technology would address all the basic requirements of high-speed backbone, and so it was decided to abandon the work on the H2 standard setting on the extension of 100 Mbps Ethernet called the high-speed Ethernet as the backbone FF network. So H1 is 31.2 kbps, we will discuss further, and H2 is 100 Mbps, which is the backbone. So remember this in foundation, because there will be two communication networks, H1 and HSE. H1 on the field devices sides and HSE on the backbone side, higher upper level side. So H1 for the H1 physical layer, for the we will be having two wire ungrounded network cable, 100 ohm nominal characteristic impedance, DC power 31.25 kbps data rate, differential voltage signaling, Manchester encoding. So that is you have studied, already studied in the communication systems course, Manchester encoding. Since DC power is conveyed over the same two wires as a digital data, it means each device only needs to connect to two wires in order to function on a H1 network segment. Now you can see this is the in the previous lecture we had the idea of computer networks. Now you can see its practical application here. Now this is a network here, these are the terminating resistances on the both sides, these are the terminators, and this will be the trunk cable, and these are the spurs, the parallel nodes. So please note that there will be only two terminating resistances. There cannot be three terminating, you cannot install terminating resistance here, no, it will not work. Again you cannot here, it will destroy your whole network. A minimal FF foundation field bus H1 segment consists of a DC power supply and power conditioner. This is the filter side. Okay, exactly two terminating resistors, one at each extreme end of the cable, shielded twisted pair, SPP. We call it SPP, shielded twisted pair, to remove all the noise and electromagnetic interference. And of course, at least two foundation field bus instruments to communicate with each other. So please recall that this is the network we studied earlier in the previous lecture. I told you there that we will be using these in automation systems. The power conditioner shown in the diagram, simplified model of the actual device, the function of which may filter out the digital pulses from reaching the DC power supply. Now here, with the terminating resistors, we also see we can have a small capacitor. This small capacitor is just to give here the infinite resistance feeling here. For proper reflection of the pulses. So this is again another deep concept, but we will not be going through too much that deep in that course, because it's not directly related to this course. We just need to understand that it is installed. It is sometimes installed. Regardless of how many FF devices H1 segment, we should exactly two terminating resistors in each segment, one at each end of the trunk cable. These resistor capacitor networks serve the sole purpose of eliminating signal reflections of the ends of the trunk cable, making the cable look infinitely long from the perspective of propagating pulse signal, because the DC is blocked by the capacitor. So here it will see as the infinite long cable. So this is a topology. Again, what is a topology? It is a network topology, how the devices are connected to. So this is a daisy chain topology. So in that topology, you can see that first the pair of wire here comes here, and then from it is further, then from here to here, and then here to here, and then terminator. So all H1 networks are essentially parallel electrical circuits, where the two connection terminals of each field instrument are connected to each other. As simple as this topology, it suffers from a major disadvantage. Now the disadvantage is, for example, if you want to make any change on here, then you have to interrupt the circuit. So that is the disadvantage of this thing. Interruption will occur even for a minor millisecond, but it will occur. It is impossible to disconnect any device in this segment without interrupting the network's continuity. Disconnecting and reconnecting, for that matter, any device necessarily results in all downstream devices losing signal. If you are doing this, you have to disconnect this, you will be removing this wire from this terminal connection together, but so that will cause the interruption of all these devices. So it will result in all downstream devices losing signal, if only for a brief time. This is an unacceptable state of affairs for most applications. So what is the solution? Solution is like this: bus or spur topology, bus topology. This is the bus, and these are the spurs. Now you can disconnect this, but will be connected to trunk. Trunk will be communicating. And alternate topology is the bus layout, where the spur shorts per cables connecting instruments to the long trunk cables. The ideal arrangement for a bus network is to minimize the length of each spur cable. Now, you have to minimize this length, this spur cable length should be minimal. We'll discuss more detail further so as to minimize the delay of the reflected signals of the unterminated ends of the rod. Now remember that only two terminating resistors are allowed in any electrical continuous network. So only two will be allowed. You can connect here and here, not here, anywhere. So only two will be allowed. And so this rule forbids the addition of terminators to the end of each spur cable. There must not be any terminating resistor in these spurs. Now this is the tree topology or chicken foot. Like it looks like chicken foot. Chicken foot topology. Now you can again see that this is another topology you can follow. Another alternative topology for H1 networks is the so-called chicken foot arrangement, where a long trunk cable terminates at a multi-point junction along with several feed devices and their spur cables. Now if anyone gets disconnected, they will no harm on the other. Most of the foundation field bus devices resemble a combination of the bus and chicken foot topologies, where multiple junction devices serve as connection points for two or more field instruments per junction. Okay, now this is the practically like figure of the plant. This is not in Pakistan. Pakistan, on which I have worked, the most modern system was with the heart communication. We had the DCS 24 volts, Foxboro Invensys IACs with the heart communication. I have not seen foundation field bus here in Pakistan, but this again, it is installed in the worldwide. So this is a picture. In order to simplify the task of connecting field bus devices to such a network segment, multiple manufacturers sell coupling devices. So this is a coupling device here. This is the coupling device on which various things are coupled. So this is a coupling device. Okay. This is again shown that how the wires are coming in the cable tray. This is a cable tray. It's coming in the cable tray, and these are the cable ties, and these are the tagging of the for which network it is the cable. Okay. So this is the diagram. Further diagram of the coupler. A coupler, you can see that this is the Pepperl and Fuchs model. This is a very famous brand. It was installed in a gas turbine of SDT 400 Siemens forgive me, I forgot the power rating of that gas turbine because of so much time. It was I remember it was 13.8 megawatt gas turbine. So this was this control was very much Pepperl Fuchs. So this is for the hazardous areas modules of this company brand. So this company is very much famous in industrial automation, especially for the classified area where there are oil and gas, like oil and gas plants, where there are intrinsically safe circuits required. Now the cable types. Now for the cable, there are four types of cable: type A, type B, type C, type D. So this is the 18 gauge, 22 gauge, 26 gauge, and 16 gauge. So these are the cable types and impedance shielding, twisted pairs, maximum length we can use on it. Now this is the layout. This is one layout in which we have a trunk cable here and spur cables. Now this is a one layout. The other layout is like this. Now what is the difference between these two layouts? There is a difference between these two layers. You can see that the transmitter is installed here, one transmitter person, and this is your control web. This is transmitter. The other layout shows that you have shifted that you have basically reduced that spur cable. That this shows that you have reduced the spur cable. If greater lengths are required to a network, devices known as repeaters may be added, which sends and across the rebroadcast the Manchester encoded FF signals. So the idea here is to reduce the spur cable. You reduce the spur cable. How you reduce the spur cable? By increasing the trunk cable. Move that coupling device here and that coupling device here. So that trunk cable will increase, but it will not affect much. We have to reduce this spur cable. So that's the idea. That's the difference between these two layout pictures. And this is the practical diagram of how things work field. Okay. Now foundation block location. Now you can see that this is automation system. Here we have the differential pressure sensor. Now what it is doing? It is basically a DPT for the flow side, or if it's type flow meter. We have greatly discussed in detail in the industrial process control circuit, industrial process control course. This is the DPP, high side and low side. This is the flow, and it is giving signal here, and that signal is coming here to the positioner. This is positioner. Positional, but and with the I to P converter, and I will be converted to P as well as positional. What is the purpose of positional? Its purpose, it's the feedback system. Its purpose is to ensure that the command is, if the command is 10%, it must have open 10%, not 20%, not 30%, only 10% because of the input command. So that is the purpose of the positioner device, to ensure the opening of control valve according to the commanded signal. So this is the purpose of the position. Okay, now you can see that this will be the configuration in the function field bus. You have analog input, its output will be going to the PID block, PID block for the input port, at the input port, this output to the input port, and then PID output will go to the analog output to the positioner, and from the positioner we will be having a feedback signal to the PID. I already told you that this is a feedback controller positioner, that to ensure that the set point has been followed. So that wire BKCAL underscore out goes to the BKCAL underscore in. All function block inputs are on the left hand side of the blocks, and all outputs on the right hand side. All inputs will be left side, outputs will be on the right side. In this function block program, data from the analog input block flows into the PID block. After calculating the proper output value, the PID block sends data to the analog output block, where the final control element, valve, variable speed motor, is adjusted. The analog output block in turn sends a back calculation signal to PID block to let it know the final control element has successfully reached the working of the positioner, the state commanded by the PID block's output. This is important for the elimination of reset to wind up in the event of final control element fails to respond to the PID block's output signal. So in the PID control, reset wind up is used to reset all the to prevent the saturation of the actuator. The actuator may not get saturated. So now you can see that there are two types, there are two ways in which the PID function can be placed. Here the PID block is placed in the transmitter side. You can see this. One option is to place at the transmitter side, other option is to place it on the actuator side. So this is again a foundation. We are discussing the foundation field bus, and its purpose is to shift the PID function to the field side, the decision making power to the field side, so that the control system may not spend its time on these things, it may spend its time on bigger tasks. So this is the idea in the foundation field bus. Okay. Now we will discuss the calibration of the instruments. In the regular analog pressure transmitter, what we will have, we have this kind of structure. Here we have the sensor part, which is basically sensing the pressure and converting to the signal, an electrical signal, which is then low pass filtered, and then it is amplified and then converted to 4 to 20 milliamps. Now here in such conventional transmitters, we have two knobs, calibration knob for the zero adjustment and span knob for the span adjustment, zero and span. For this is a very difficult. I had the experience of calibration of such type of transmitter. If we adjust the zero, its span gets disturbed, and when we set the zero span gets disturbed, and when we set the span the maximum value, its a zero gets disturbed. So we have to do multiple times these things to properly calibrate the transmitter. So this is all about the analog pressure transmitter. This is a non-smart. We don't have any processor here. This is a non-smart pressure transmitter. The currently we are using with the heart is the smart transmitters. In the smart transmitter we have a processor here, we have a brain. So this sensor value, it is converted to the analog to digital converter, then digital value and then digital to analog converter value, and it's converted to 4 to 20. Now with this microprocessor ability, we can connect our heart communicator 375, 475 with it, and we can set the upper range value and lower range value. Lower range value, LRV, upper range value, URV and DRV values. And these are the trims, analog to digital trim, low trim, high trim, similarly digital to analog trim, low trim and high trim, set points of these two circuits, and these are the LR, URV and settings. These are the settings. This we can do with the regular hard computer. By contrast, a smart digital transmitter could be then analog 4 to 20 milliampere current output distinctly separates the calibration and range functions, each function treatment by a different set of adjustments. Now, calibration of the smart transmitter consists of applying known input stimuli to the instrument. Now, what's the difference? Now you can see that in that case, if there is a transmitter which is calibrated for 0 to 100 psi, now we want to use it at some place where it is difficult, for example it's 150 psi. Now what you will need to do, you will again apply pressure it. You have to apply pressure it for the calibration. But in that case, in that smart transmitter, you don't need to apply pressure again and again. You just need to just change. For example, at 0 psi it should generate 4 milliampere. At 100 psi it was previously generating 20. Now you want to use 150 psi to generate 20 milliampere. Now then what you need in the conventional transmitter, you need to apply that pressure and do all calibration altogether again. But in the smart transmitter, you don't need to apply that pressure. You just need to apply that pressure for one time calibration, and for the other time you just need to adjust this URB, for example LRB and URB. You just need to play with these two parameters. For example, if you want to use 0 to 100 psi to 150, 0 to 150 psi, you just change URB to 150 through the heart communicator. Your transmitter will now be generating 20 milliampere for 150. Previously it was generating 20 milliampere for 100. So that's the difference. It is explained here. Establish the mathematical relationship to illustrate the difference between calibration and aging. Consider a gauge pressure transmitter used to water pressure in a pipe. Suppose the transmitter's pressure output range is 0 to 100 psi, translate book 20 milliampere. If we desire to rearrange analog transmitter to measure greater span, we would have to reapply the pressure of 0 to 150 psi to generate this thing. In the smart measuring instrument, however, calibration against a node standard source need only be done at the specific intervals. You just need to change the UR for using that transmitter of 0 to 100 to 150 pg. In the foundation field bus, we have this kind of structure. Here we have the A to D converter, and then this is the processor side, and this is the digital data. Again, you can see that there is no further analog to digital conversion here, and digital one time conversion is required to convert this analog value to digital. This is required. This is the built-in, you can say, this feature. It's not here, it's not on this side. So you can see that we have a lot of parameters, and the greatest advantage of digital communication is that we have a lot of communication flexibility. We have a lot of parameters about that. So you can see that in-bus instruments, of course, are smart in the same way. Their internal block diagrams look much the same as a smart transmitter with analog current output, albeit with a greater number of parameters within each block. We have more parameters, we have more information. The rectangle labeled as D in the following diagram is the transducer block, and while the rectangle AI is the analog block. Now, how will you calibrate this FF instrument? We will see this. For example, you have an FF level transmitter. Again, please note that this is again a differential pressure transmitter used for the level application. We have applied that pressure. This is the impulse line, which is on the high side, and low side is vent to atmosphere. Now you can see that from the formula we see that P is equal to rho h. This is gamma h. Gamma is the specific density, 449.3 pound per foot cube. Hydrostatic pressure extent on the transmitter sensing element is producing liquid density gamma and vertical liquid column height h. When the tank is empty, there will still be a vertical column of ethanol. So when the tank is empty, suppose the tank is empty now, you will still be having a height of 10 feet here. This is an offset. This is the light zero, you can say 4 milliamps. So here 10 feet will be equal to 0 U. So you will be having some pressure here when the tank is empty. How much pressure will be between 49.3 into 10? It will be 3.424. You will be having 3.424 psi when there is nothing in the tank. So this will be our zero. And when we have the liquid tank filled, we have 40 feet. So 40 plus 10 will be 50 feet. So our 100% will be at 50 feet. You can see it here, 49.3 multiplied by 50, 17.1. So our level, when our level changes, this pressure changes. When its level is 0, its pressure is 3.424 we are reading here. And when the level is 50 feet, we are reading the pressure 17.124. So our calibration will be here 4 milliampere and here will be 20 milliampere. So how we will configure it in the field bus? So in the field bus, we have three important parameters, enter, XT scale and output
scale. L-drive means scale level measurement is indirect. This is indirect level measurement. This is the level measurement through pressure. That is why it is known as indirect. And 3.4 to 4 to 17.12 psi, and output scale will be 0 to 40 feet. Okay. So this will be the calibration. This is how we will calibrate. This is all explained in this paragraph, that it will be 0 to 40 feet. This will be on the output scale parameter, and on the XT scale we will be feeding this these parameters. So we will be feeding these parameters to the foundation field bus device for configuration of this and calibration of this. The other application is the flow. For example, previously it was level, now it is the flow. Again, it is again the DP side, DPT, differential pressure transmitter. This is the high side and this is the low side. Now, the calibration we need to done is 0 to 125 water columns, inches of water column, and it will be scaled to 0 to 350. If we are reading zero pressure here, they keep it as zero. If we are reading 125, that is the maximum upper age value you are keeping 350 GPM. So how we will insert this for the foundation field bus? L type is the indirect scale. Again, this is indirect measurement of the flow through the TPT transmitter. XP scale 0 water to 125 inches water. Output scale will be 0 to 350 GPM. So this is how you calibrate the foundation field bus device. So this type of question can be asked in the examination. So you must remember these three parameters important for properly calibrate a foundation field bus. So this is all about foundation field bus. We are discussing the advanced communication in industrial automation systems. So we have discussed almost all types of advanced communication in the automation systems, like RS-232, RS-485, Modbus, Ethernet, and field bus. Then today we have discussed the hard communication at field bus communication. Now we also discussed the Profibus, Profibus DP, Profibus PA. And this is all about the communication systems. The other one communication is the wireless communication, because I have not seen, but such type of wireless transmitters are installed in the field devices. This is the wireless hard, like wireless hard communication. So we will be discussing wireless communication, basics of the wireless communication and relevant information related to the industrial automation in the next week lectures. So thank you very much for listening.